had a way of looking at things. "Why do we call it Earth?" she said. "We should call it sea. After all, our planet is 70% water, almost the same as our bodies." She always said, "We've got salt water flowing through our veins, and that when I cried, it was just the ocean trying to get back home." As a child, I'd stand on the shore and think, nothing is more big and powerful than the ocean. But I soon learned, just underneath the surface lies its delicate heart. A coral reef. This was my special playground when I was little. I was a mermaid, and I forgot the world back up on land. Floating in the shimmering waters, I would feel the heartbeat of the vast sea, and the life that pulsed through its currents like blood through veins. They were so close, yet as mysterious as the stars. Coral reefs are as rare as rubies, flung out like a handful of necklaces around the globe. And we're just beginning to explore their secrets. This is not a fairy tale. This is a story of survival for all of us. I'm going to tell you about one coral reef and how I learned to listen to it.
Welcome to the southernmost point of the United States of America. We are 90 miles from Cuba, 157 miles from Miami, here in Key West, Florida, America's Caribbean island.
Well, I'm going down to the seaside, have a little fun.
Growing up in the Keys was paradise. Down here in the Conch Republic, nobody cared about rules and regulations. It was home for eccentric characters of every stripe. One big party round the clock. It was not an ordinary childhood.
Now here's my best move. This one's tough. The first folds in half, then you fold it into fourths.
I'm here for the fishing. But she's
for man, not the fish.
In my lifetime, it has become a magnet for tourists. It wasn't always like that. In Grandma's day, respectable members of society wouldn't dream of setting foot here. They thought the Keys were the end of the world, just a bunch of wild tropical islands where the mosquitoes were big enough to carry you out to sea, and you had to take a boat to get here. The only people who lived here were the native fishermen, called conchs, and a shady assortment of smugglers, bootleggers, and treasure hunters hiding out from the long arm of the law. It was a place for real men. Tough guys like Hemingway, who boasted of their close encounters with gangsters and fish. You never knew what might happen to you living in a rough place like this. But this wasn't anything a little bit of advertising couldn't fix.
Hi, I'm Anita Bryant, and this is my husband, Bob Green. And we'd like to take you to a very special place.
Oh, come along with me to my little corner of the world and dream a little dream in my little corner of the world.
Advertising did its trick. Millions of people flock to the Florida Keys every year. But you know the main reason they come? To visit the coral reef. Jacques Cousteau helped invent scuba diving after World War II. Until then, the reefs might as well have been the Kingdom of Oz, for all we knew. The only reports of them were those brought back by the truly adventurous.
When I came here in 1948, you can't describe to people how beautiful it was. The colors of the reef, the fans, the gold tint of staghorn, pillar coral, just huge. I mean, it came up from the bottom to about 25 feet, pillar coral. We call it the pillar coral.
Now you can look at something day after day and not really notice it. But then one day you have to open your eyes and see what's really there.
I went out on the reef about 6 months ago. I couldn't believe what had happened. Everything's dying. Everything is dying.
I saw the changes. But I hoped maybe it was just a cycle on part of the reef, some fluke of nature. But evidence showed that the reefs all along the Keys were in trouble.
We've been studying intensively six reefs in the Florida Keys for the last 7 years. Some reefs in the lower Keys have lost as much as half of all their living coral in the 7 years since we began our study. Reefs cannot sustain this kind of coral loss and continue to be reefs as we know them. In the areas that are hardest hit, the ones that are losing coral at a fastest rate, those particular reefs could be gone within 10 years.
On my 13th birthday, I went out for my first nighttime dive. Up until then, I thought the reef was a garden of pretty rocks and ferns. But in a spellbinding moment, I realized that my coral was very much alive. Grandma showed me the tiny creatures that build the reefs, coral polyps. These little animals come out at night to feed on bits of plankton floating by. The soft polyps extract calcium carbonate from the seawater, then build protective skeletons around themselves to live in. Coral skeletons and human bones are so similar that doctors can use coral for bone repairs. Thousands upon thousands of polyps together make up colonies, and these colonies build everything from wispy soft coral to craggy hard coral. Each one of them alive. And the polyps are not alone in the colonies. Inside the tiny animal polyps live microscopic plants called zooxanthellae. It took Grandma a week to teach me how to say that. Just like the flowers in Grandma's garden, the zooxanthellae add color to the reef. Like all plants, the zooxanthellae make food from sunlight and convert carbon dioxide into oxygen. They give these gifts to the polyp and in return are given a home. It is this perfect partnership between plant and animal that creates the magical structures of the reef. And some of the most productive places on the planet. This is the only barrier reef off the mainland United States. It curves 200 miles out from the southern tip of Florida, like the tail of a kite, protecting the Keys. Besides the fact that we would literally wash away in the next hurricane if it weren't there, no one would be able to make a living without the coral reef.
Each of us are all intertwined in our relationship with the reef. It doesn't matter whether it's a tropical fish collector like me, or a jewfish fisherman, snapper grouper fisherman, or just the plain guy who wants to retire. The reef affects us all. We all have our livelihoods intertwined in the reef.
It's hard to ignore your environment when everything you do is dependent on it. So you can be sure, we all wanted to know what was killing the coral.
Last night, the 80,000-ton freighter Maitland ran aground on Molasses Reef off Key Largo. Investigators aren't sure what caused the ship to stray off course, but early reports may point to a failure of the net.
Three freighters in 3 months ran aground on the reefs. This is where we first began to pick up the trail of the killer.
I think it's clear to say that the mechanical impact of man has been demonstrated many times over by the more dramatic large ship drownings on the Florida Reef Track, where clearly acres of corals have been destroyed. But it's the week-to-week damage done by the smaller sport diving boats, fishing boats, cabin cruisers, runabouts, that are literally chipping away at the reef.
Around here, we call Dr. Hudson the Reef Doctor. He's been figuring out ways to heal coral longer than anyone.
Okay, I think we're about ready.
And he's one of the few doctors who still makes house calls.
There's four or five massive coral heads that are impacted by the propeller blades, and one of the coral heads has a fracture about a half a meter through the top of it, so it received a pretty good lick. We're going to re-cement the fractured pieces. What this cement will do is hold the fracture in place, and then hopefully in the next year or so the coral will continue to heal itself, much like our bodies would heal a broken bone. Well, I believe we did a good repair, Paige.
I think so. I think that'll work out well.
I think it'll look pretty well. But time will tell.
The main damage we noticed to the reef was anchor damage, but it was all broken. In 1975, we started a charter business here in Key West, taking people out to the reef to snorkel on the reef.
The increase in traffic on the reef has been tremendous. Where there used to be one boat at the reef all day, there were maybe 20 boats. To this day, it's probably tripled to that. You may have 60 boats out to the same reef.
Boat damage is one thing. But last year alone, 1 million divers visited the reefs at John Pennekamp State Park.
Now we're at White Banks Reef. If you look directly ahead of the boat, that is all the coral reef. And once again, I want to remind you that there's no touching of the coral, no standing up out there, and that's very important because by standing up or touching the coral, you are killing it.
When I was a girl, it was nothing to break off a piece of coral as a souvenir. But then again, I could be out here all day and it was just me and the fish. Nowadays, the whole world knows of my secret kingdom. The Florida reefs are the number one dive destination in the world. Our love for coral was only the most obvious suspect. Looking for the killer was like peeling back the layers of an onion. Here under the sea, it's the other side of the looking glass. The sun is cool and purple overhead. The fish move like birds through trees of coral, singing with color and pattern. The reef is as diverse and packed with life as a tropical rainforest. But it is more than a jungle. It's a city as complex as New York or Paris or Beijing. Like those capitals on land, this is where all the ocean's creatures come at one time or another. They're here to visit, to find a mate, to eat, sometimes each other. They come to give birth. Wealth is created here in the form of life. This life pours back out into the open waters. 1/4 of the sea's population lives on reefs, drawing from their rich diversity. Each citizen of the reef has a role to play. Coral polyps are the builders. Then there are police, and garbage collectors, and bullies. There are schools. There are pretty ladies. And there are gardeners. Parrotfish graze down the algae that grows on coral. If they weren't there, the algae would grow wild like thick grass over the coral city, smothering the polyps to death. The foundation for the reef would be broken, and this civilization would begin to fall apart.
The fish populations in the Florida Keys 25 to 30 years ago were absolutely incredible. The average person just cannot comprehend the incredible density and size of fish, lobsters, conch, all of those fish that we love to eat and enjoy were here in just incredible numbers.
Fish today don't only mean food. They mean business. Fishing industries bring billions of dollars into the Keys economy. People have always caught fish, but now we're taking them faster than they're being born.
There's a natural balance between the fish life, the corals, and all of the other reef creatures that take advantage of the structure that we call a coral reef.
What a man!
When you remove the fish from the system, you upset that natural balance that has evolved over just countless years. Our food fish have been stripped from our reefs. Today, it's obvious that our reefs are barren. That's the only word to use.
If the coral is all broken up, the fish are left homeless. And when too many fish are taken away, the whole ecosystem crashes. The reef just dies of loneliness. The thing about ecosystems is, it's hard to find their borders. The keys are actually ancient reefs that became islands when the sea level fell during the last ice age. As this happened, the coral polyps moved further out to sea and started building the reefs that are here now. Vast meadows of seagrass carpet the seafloor between the reefs and the keys. Mangroves grow like a fringe knitted around the islands. This is where the land and the sea come together. I loved going out in my grandmother's canoe and poking around in the backcountry. Grandma said, if you keep real still, you might could see the ibises in their rookeries feeding their babies. I thought the roots of the mangrove trees looked like strong hands reaching down into the water. They actually do hold the soil of the keys in place, so the reefs don't get buried in mud. They keep the water clean by filtering it through their roots. Fish from the reef swim here to lay their eggs. Decaying leaves captured by the roots provide plenty to eat for the little ones. The fingers on the mangroves protect them until they are big enough to claim their spot on the reef. Like meadows on land, the seagrass is where many creatures of the ocean come to play and sun themselves. In these shallow waters, they can find food and safe places to hide. The mangroves and seagrass help nurture the living reef. The reefs, in turn, protect these parts of their ecosystem from storms and hurricanes. That's how it's been here for thousands of years. And then we came along.
Uniting the isolated Florida Keys with the U.S. mainland, the railroad that went to sea. The dream of one man, Henry Flagler, entrepreneur, engineer, visionary. The work began in 1904. Flagler's intrepid workers hacked their way through tangled mangrove swamps. They cut coral from the seafloor to make bridge pilings. They constructed a chain of causeways to carry tracks of steel all the way from Miami to Key West. The devastating Labor Day hurricane of 1935 tore the tracks from the bridges, but that couldn't stop progress. A paved roadway took their place, and the remote Florida Keys became the only tropical islands in the world that you could drive to.
For the coral, the railroad turned out to be Pandora's box. The waves of people that followed brought drastic changes to the islands, and the coral has been writing that story down in its bones.
The
annual bands that you see in corals are identical to the annual bands in trees. These rings are laid down every year, and the distance between them tells the health of the environment in which the coral grew. When the environment is a healthy environment, coral growth is rapid. When the environment deteriorates, those growth rates deteriorate. For instance, after the railroad was put through between Miami and Key West, the space between the annual bands of corals near the construction sites decreased, telling us exactly to the year and sometimes to the month the exact time that the railroad crew began construction in that area.
Over the past 20 years, it seems the Keys have just developed overnight. Condos, townhouses, timeshares, canals, causeways, all these things combined to put an unnecessary burden of development on the Florida Keys.
Mangroves once stood here, and these waters were as clear as gin. Without the mangroves to filter the water, it is often cloudy with sediment. Sunlight can't get through to the seagrass meadows or to the coral. I know people live in Seattle without sunlight, but the coral's just not made that way. As the houses go up, the coral falls down.
We're down in Key West, we don't care.
Everyone knows the story of the flood and Noah's Ark. Grandma said the story means we need to go through this world two by two, because without a partner, all our work comes to nothing. The coral polyp and the zooxanthellae have been laboring together in a relationship that has lasted half a billion years. But lately, the polyps in some coral have been expelling their zooxanthellae. Scientists speculate about the reason. Maybe it's all that sediment in the water, or maybe the sea is too hot because of global warming. Whatever. When the zooxanthellae leave, the coral begins to fade. If they come back, the coral can recover its health. But like a bad marriage, after one too many separations, the partnership is doomed. The coral dies, turning as white as a bleached bone.
all of us have had to change here, a lot of the ways that we looked at the resource and our own impact. And I think we need to realize, because there's so many more people, our cumulative impact, you know, even when you're looking at something that you might have done as an individual 20 years ago that didn't do any harm, now you have to realize there might be another 100 people doing that today. And when you add all of that up, that it has the potential for destroying a lot of what surrounds us.
I think if you look at it like a savings account in the bank, and you're only spending your interest every year, you're in fine shape. You've got that principal for years to come. But the trouble is, we've just been dipping into the principal too long.
We have to solve the problem here. You're not going to go away from the Keys and find a better place. You're going to find worse problems or the same problems. So it's just time for all of us to buckle down and let's change things. Let's turn things around.
Craig and Devon took action and started a group in 1986 to do something to help the reef. They called it Reef Relief.
You gotta watch me the whole time I'm down.
We originally started Reef Relief to install reef mooring buoys to eliminate the need to anchor near a coral reef.
We soon learned that putting in buoys alone wasn't enough, that it had to be accompanied by a vigorous public awareness campaign. Not only specifically did boaters need to know how to use the buoys, but visitors needed to know not to step, touch, or stand on the coral. So we started a campaign to teach people that coral is a living animal, that it is fragile, and how they can actively protect it.
Buoys would probably be a week. The rest should be one.
Encased in the hard coral of a brain coral is a little animal. Does anybody know the name of that little animal?
Plops or something like that?
Polyp, a coral polyp. This little coral polyp encased in the hard coral is very delicate. When people stand on it, they crush the polyp.
Reef Relief helped inspire a whole rash of activities. The community came together and set limits on fishing. They stopped some development projects in sensitive areas. And they helped establish the Florida Keys National Marine Sanctuary to protect the waters around the reefs.
Captain Tony, how are you doing?
Oh, that's
so
healthy.
I wanted to make sure that you had an invitation to attend it.
You know, we're backing you 100%.
It's a gorgeous 95 degrees outside our studios in Key West, and today is Reef Relief's annual cleanup day. So put on your bathing suit and your sunscreen and help those good folks at Reef Relief keep our waters beautiful. Remember, there's only one reef, and nobody's going to take care of it except for you.
It seemed the nightmare would soon be over, but the coral reef was still in danger. More layers of the onion to peel back.
After all the things we've done, we fought offshore oil, we fought about debris in the ocean, we put mooring buoys in, we tried to educate, but we realized that this wasn't nipping the problem in the bud. The water around Key West used to always be clean and clear. All of a sudden, there was filamentous green stuff in the water. There was algae, and we realized that we have a water quality problem.
Coal miners used to take canaries down into the tunnels with them to warn of any poisonous gases in the air. If the birds died, the miners knew they had to get out before the gas killed them, too. Coral polyps are like those canaries. If something is out of balance in the waters, the polyps feel it. They are the first in the sea to sicken and die. They are a kind of early warning system for the health of the oceans. This chills me right to the bone. When the coal miners saw those dead canaries, they could save themselves by leaving the mine. When we see the reefs dying, where are we going to go?
An area here in the Key Largo Sanctuary we call the algae reef. Without exaggeration, thousands of soft corals, sea fan, sea rod, sea whip, sea plume, have been selectively killed. The inshore reef areas are getting hit by pollution runoff. It's devastating to the corals.
It's a major misfortune for the Florida Keys that water quality is the real killer, and it's the hardest thing to identify. What is poor water quality? What creates water to be green? Well, it could be phosphates, it could be sewage, it can be runoff from the roads, automobiles, things that we all live with.
Million people visit Key West every year. Waste. You know what I'm talking about. It goes right through the porous ground and out into one big septic tank, the ocean. Sewage and phosphates from detergents become powerful fertilizers on the reef. You can just about see the algae growing. Then there's all the chemicals that are a part of our everyday lives. Every time a rainstorm sweeps over the Keys, which, believe me, is often, these poisons get washed out to sea. Toxic chemicals have turned up everywhere on the reef, in the lobsters and the fish that we eat, in the coral itself. And now there is an outbreak of plagues appearing on the reef.
We started working with black band disease back in 1986. It was through those studies that I came to realize that this disease was having a profound impact on the head coral population on the Florida Reef Tract. A 200-year-old coral head could lose one-half to two-thirds of its live tissue in less than 6 months. So what it took Mother Nature 200 years to create, this disease could destroy in less than a year.
The only way the reef doctor has figured out how to treat this disease is to use an aspirator that pulls the deadly bacteria right off the coral. It works, but it's time-consuming. One man in a big ocean with a vacuum cleaner. Once in a while, my grandmother would would take me up to Florida Bay to go tarpon fishing. It was a real hoot watching Grandma reel in something as big as her kitchen table. Grandma told me this was another place that God had made special just for fish. This is where the salt water from the ocean marries the fresh water from the land, she would say. When the two come together, they're so happy they spin and dance their way all around the Keys. Water is the greatest traveler there is. By this afternoon, this water here under our boat will be flowing out over the reef.
In 1983, we started having major algae blooms, and from 83 on, especially from 85 on, we started seeing a major decline in our fisheries. The water went from clear water to turbid water where you could no longer see the bottom. It used to be in places where we could look over and see our traps in 15 feet of water. We could see the lobsters in them. And then it got to the point where we could only see a foot down the ropes. And after that, the decline in the fisheries was astronomical. It went down rapidly.
We call it the dead zone. It's algae. It consumes oxygen and blocks sunlight, just like it does on the reef. A cancer feeding on polluted water. Now maybe we could clean up the algae in the bay and on the reef if the pollution was just coming from the Keys. But it's not. It's coming from the mainland, out of the Everglades.
We used to go out as far as the Dade County line and build a fire and cook breakfast and look at the birds, and you can look out and see the Everglades as they were. You saw the untouched Everglades. You saw the open country.
Marjorie Stoneman Douglas was born in 1890, and no one alive saw the Everglades as she did. Marjorie wrote The River of Grass. The miracle of the light pours over the green and brown expanse of sawgrass and of water, shining and slow moving below. The grass and the water that is the meaning and the central fact of the Everglades of Florida. It is a river of grass. They are the only Everglades in the world. The book was written in 1947, before the changes came.
The Army Corps of Engineers has reclaimed unproductive land in the Everglades. Historically, the winding Kissimmee River frequently overflowed its banks, flooding adjacent land. The Army Corps straightened the river, and it now flows due south into Lake Okeechobee. From here, the water can be controlled and released for best use practices through an ingenious system of levees, dikes, and canals. These massive flood control projects have opened thousands of acres of previously useless Florida muckland for development. Where once sawgrass was king, now cattle rule. Where there was an uninhabitable swamp, farm communities thrive, trucking fruits and vegetables north to feed our hungry cities. Where water stood waist deep, now sugarcane grows high in the nitrogen-rich soil, all adding millions to the state's economy. Thanks to superior technology, it's the dawn of a new age for the Florida Everglades.
Marjorie wrote that the whole system of the Everglades was like a set of scales. Our tampering threw the scales off balance. The once meandering Kissimmee River now runs straight as an arrow into Lake Okeechobee, dumping farm chemicals and silt directly into her banks. The now polluted water in the lake is walled in and only allowed to exit in regimented canals at times the authorities decide, instead of when the Everglades need it. The ancient clear sheet flow to the Everglades is siphoned off for our needs, and the river of grass gets the dirty leftovers. Florida Bay, denied its clean, fresh water, is too sickly to fight off the algae. And the water that makes it to the coral reefs?
Just what I've been saying, that we've got to restore the Kissimmee River, we've got to clean up Lake Okeechobee, we've got to maintain the sheet flow of the Everglades. I keep on saying that.
One of the really interesting things about the management of water, both marine water and fresh water in South Florida, is the fact that the usual scientific method is to break a problem into smaller and smaller parts. But in this instance, we've understood the problems only by backing away from them, by viewing Florida from a satellite perspective. And by doing so, understanding for the first time that the health and survival of these coral reefs in the Florida Keys is affected in part by the quality of the management of land and water 200 miles to the north in Lake Okeechobee and the intervening lands.
Runoff and sewage from metropolitan Miami stream down the seaboard and over the coral reefs. Looking even wider, industrial and farm chemicals wash into the Mississippi River. They pour out of the delta and head down towards Florida Bay. Pesticides sprayed on crops in Central America and Cuba are washed out to sea, get swept up in the Gulf Stream, and head up towards the reef. Like our tears, all water flows back home to the sea. With the world's population expected to double in the next 50 years, our reefs will become more contaminated. Any map will tell you there are six oceans on our planet, but water doesn't respect boundaries. There's just one big ocean. A drop of water in the Sea of Japan will end up in a wave off Key Largo someday. Everything I put down my drain eventually is going to find its way to every reef all around the world. And today, reefs everywhere are dying. We really don't know what will happen if the coral reefs disappear from the earth. The last time the coral died out was when the dinosaurs became extinct.
If we really and truly want to save the reefs and save the oceans of the world, we sort of have to rethink the way we live. We started out wanting to save the reef with mooring buoys, and all of a sudden we're confronted with these global issues, things that we never imagined would affect us. The coral reefs are dying. They're dying in oceans. Oceans are global things. They're affected by waters that come from all parts of the world. So we're looking at issues now we never imagined that we'd look at.
We can't go back, but we can choose how we go forward. The first step is to restore our partnership with Mother Nature. The Army Corps of Engineers is putting the kinks back into the Kissimmee River. progress is being made to restore the proper clean water flow to the Everglades. Mangrove habitats are being recreated to help clean up the water in Florida Bay. And the next step is to realize that even a little ripple can become a tidal wave. Groups like Reef Relief continue their successful campaign to educate people around the world. And you'll still find the reef doctor making a big difference in his own way.
I would have to say that coral restoration work in general and the restoration work on some of these massive pillars, it just has to be the most rewarding work that I've ever done. And to know that this work is actually saving the life of a coral that in all probability is several hundred years old, to be able to do something positive, it's just a really good feeling.
Happens only once a year, at the same time, all over the planet. It must be a warm night in August, just past sunset. The tide must be high, the water absolutely calm. And one more thing, the moon has to be full. When everything is just right, the polyps on the reef fill the water with clouds of their eggs and seed. The clouds drift over the reef, creating a new generation. Coral colonies of the future. The official name for this is spawning. The wisest woman I know would say spawning's not its true name. She would say the name of the future is hope. The last time I went diving with Grandma, she said there were treasures hidden in the coral. But she wasn't talking about Spanish doubloons or sparkling jewels. She was talking about the voices from the ocean. The seas are silent, she said, but the reefs speak. They tell us all we need to know if we're willing to listen. I was born from a little sea of salt water in my mother's belly. Only now do I realize we are all children of this water planet, and that something as alien as coral is so intertwined with our existence. I have dreams that my grandchildren will drift among the corals and feel this kinship. And I pray the ocean, the oldest grandmother of all, can forgive our mistakes. And I hope the canary keeps singing.